Thank you very much, and thank you very much to Georgetown University for the invitation to this esteemed event. I'm going to take a slightly different tact on this panel and speak more from the perspective of a practitioner than just a policymaker in terms of some of the preconditions that we need to look at if we are going to take on big questions like escalation on state-to-state cyber or cooperation between states on dealing with cyber crime or definitions of what is a cyber attack, cyber espionage as opposed to intellectual property theft. And I think the real thing that we avoid here, and sometimes we avoid it because of the fact that policy communities and technical communities tend to live separate lives, is the fact that the big missing component for addressing any of those issues is a lack of not just situational awareness in cyberspace, but situational understanding in cyberspace. How do we actually describe what it is that we are seeing? How do we actually have a shared understanding of that we can communicate so that there is a joint basis for action? Before we talk about CBEs, before we talk about escalatory models, that is a crucial prerequisite. Now, there are a couple of characteristics of cyber and cyberspace that I think all of us take for granted, but sometimes don't really analyze exactly what they mean. First is that cyberspace is a synthetic domain, but with a very real physical presence. And a number of speakers have said this already, but I think there's an important point in understanding that the synthetic aspect of cyberspace means that it is a domain which is uniquely described in data. Nothing that exists in cyberspace does not leave a trace which is quantifiable and capturable and ultimately subject to analysis. Secondly, that data resides, transits, or is created by physical devices, physical endpoints that have both a temporal, a geographic, and a social component. Those three things can be correlated, and those three things can give you a bordered territorial internet, even without the imposition or the changes in the governance environment to make it so. Now, what that means, the combination of those two things, is that if you're going to be addressing insecurity in cyberspace, what you really want to be able to do is to detect weak signals and to be able to link those weak signals to time, space, and person. And the question is, how do you do that? Who's responsible for it, and how does it get implemented? So first I want to talk a little bit about what to monitor. I think there's a misconception because so much of the technical debate around detection of cyber events has come from the technical community, even if they are members of the intelligence community but sitting within the technical side, that there's a preponderance, if you like, I'd say a domination of looking for technical characteristics to describe these events. Now, we know from past practice, historically, that if you are going to be verifying the presence of weapons or capabilities, you don't rely on a single int. You do not rely for the detection of nuclear tests just on seismic evidence. You don't rely on just imagery intelligence. You don't rely on just satellite intelligence. You don't rely on just human sources. You rely on a combination of these things in order to give you providence over whether or not an event has taken place, has not taken place, or whether the capability exists or doesn't exist. The same thing holds true for cyberspace. We should not be looking at the identification of malfeasance, whether we call it espionage, warfare, or attacks, simply in its digital forensic characteristics. We need to be looking at it from a cross-domain perspective. And the big challenge that we currently have is, we do not have a generation of all-source analysts who know how to do cross-domain analytics in cyber. That will take time to develop, but it will come because of the fact that the data available to do it exists uniquely in cyberspace in a way that it doesn't in other kinds of events. I'd say also that how we do it is going to be complex, because it has to define between two features of being able to build situational awareness in cyberspace, which require slightly different capabilities and slightly different mandates. One is a capability for strategic listening. The strategic listening capability is one which should be reflected in the shared norms and standards that all nations, would use as a measure for saying whether or not an event can be classified as being A or B in terms of cyberspace. But strategic listening, as I said, is cross-domain, so building that metrics involves a much more complex process than it is simply setting technical standards. Second one is tactical targeting. Tactical targeting gives you the cue for being able to do response. That will always stay within the nation state level and will always be under the purview of those actors who are warranted to carry out, conceptualize, carry out these types of operations within the legal framework itself. Who is going to be providing situational awareness in cyberspace? And here I'd like to take exception with some of the statements that have been made by participants in this forum, and indeed most forums dealing with cyberspace over the last little while, in that the internet is a borderless world which somehow forces us to go beyond the Westphalian model. To that, I say nonsense. Cyberspace has a territorial embodiment which falls within national jurisdictions, and that is called the telecommunications industry. Telecommunications, pretty well universally across all countries in the world, is among the most heavily regulated industries that exists. Problem is that the internet has been treated as an overlay network to telecommunications. If we wound back the clock 10, 15 years, we could make a typological separation between ISPs, who rented capabilities from telecoms, and the telecoms themselves. Currently, that distinction does not exist. And it is at the telecoms level where national jurisdiction, physical aspects of the internet, as well as the virtual management components of the internet, including DNS, BGP, ASs, IP address allocation, all converge into one. And where national legislation, including existing policing powers, create a framework for being able to address security at that level. Telcos are also interesting in the sense that they do not fall under the same jurisdictional traps that, for example, law enforcement and intelligence agencies do. In Canada, the Communications Security Establishment, which is the equivalent of the NSA, does not have the right to collect IP addresses of individual Canadians because that is considered to be PII. A telco operator can routinely look at the social, temporal, and geographic location of IP addresses if it is a component of managing the performance of their networks. I would put to you that security is a component of managing the performance of networks, and yet this is a component that, at least in Canada, the government has not taken on as a means of providing something which I think is the most effective way of being able to deal with the problem of cybersecurity, other than playing whack-a-mole like a lot of the cybersecurity industry does, and that is doing upstream security, to be able to detect weak signals at scale and to deal with them before they reach the hundreds and thousands of companies that we are now expecting to magically start sharing security information through Facebook or whatever other kinds of means. Now, why do I think that telcos are the future? I think it's because there are a number of trends here globally that we tend to overlook, but yet if we were going to be having this discussion in 5-10 years, we'll actually frame the way that we look at cybersecurity and indeed the nature of cyberspace itself. First of all, as my colleague Ron Diebert earlier said, there is a demographic shift in cyberspace. It is moving to the south and to the east. We are seeing the preponderance of those who are coming online coming from the other 219 countries other than the United States. That is where the heart is. But what does that mean? That just doesn't mean that we have more people from the south. That means we have people who are going to be accessing with the internet in their own language and caring about the things that affect their communities. The internet will become balkanized, not by fiat, by a decision at the wicked to somehow create digital borders. It will become balkanized because, let's face it, most people care about what's going on in their community, whether that's described by where they live or the language that they speak. Secondly, telecommunications carriers are becoming cloud providers. In other words, those services which previously would have been centralized and aggregated in data farms in Southern California and Nevada and spread across the world are now being offered by Kazakh Telecom. They are being offered at a cheaper price. than can be offered by serving a service from somewhere in the United States. So you are starting to see those functions which we see as being the global internet now becoming localized and localized within telecommunications carriers themselves. And the same to some extent is true also in North America. Thirdly, net neutrality is dead when we talk about the mobile internet. And the mobile internet is what the next billion is going to be joining into. Therefore, states can very easily start reinstating and are reinstating digital borders, not by getting ICANN or the ITU to agree to it, but by simply creating a tariff barrier between accessing data locally or having to go out of network to be able to access it itself. So, as far as I'm concerned, the internet is dead. Long live the internet. This is the new reality that we're in. What it does create, however, is a different paradigm for being able to understand both the level at which cybersecurity should and can be handled without necessarily having to engage ourselves in rather pointless, holistic exercises of getting everyone to share data, upstream security, and secondly, a means by which we can establish a set of criteria, measures, which correspond with the Westphalian model that has served us well up to now and which is unlikely to change despite the emergence of a global internet era. Thank you.